the next talk will be the hair raising experience, optimizing hair transplant. And the speaker will be Dr. P. Rajendran. He has also done his MCH from Madras Medical College 2007 to 2010. He's done his MRCS in 2008 and DIPNP in 2013. He is the consultant plastic surgeon and medical director of Aura Plastic Surgery. His fields of interest are cosmetic surgery, hair transplantation, liposuction, fat grafting, wound management, diabetic foot, trauma reconstruction, hand surgery, micro and microneural surgery. And the moderator for this session would be Dr. K. Ramachandran, senior consultant plastic surgeon at the Apollo Spectra Hospital, MRC Nagar, Chennai. Over to you, sir.
Good evening, everybody. I'm just joining towards the fag end of the last session. And so, since the medical management has already been reasonably covered, I would request Dr. Karthikeyan to proceed with the introduction of the speaker who is going to talk, and then we can probably have the discussion once his talk is over.
Sir, yes, sir. I've given you, he can start talking, sir. Dr. Raj. Okay.
Can I start sharing the screen, sir?
Yeah, please go ahead. 1 minute. Yeah.
Is the screen visible, sir? Can I go ahead?
Visible. Go ahead.
Just a second.
Yeah, we can see the screen.
So good evening, everyone. At the outset, thanks to Professor GK for the stage, and it's a real honor to present about hair transplant with Ramji sir as moderator, one of the pioneers of IFE in our state. So greetings from Aura Plastic Surgery and Nova Cosmetic Center. My talk today will be basically about based on this CTQS concept. This was proposed by Dr. Carlos Pio, who says these are some critical steps that are required to produce a quality outcome in a hair transplant. And he insists that these are the steps that needs to be done by the trained surgeon himself. There's no outsourcing in hair transplant. There was a discussion just a few minutes back about this. TCC sir was saying this has been outsourced. So we can proudly say last 8 to 10 years, we have been doing it all about ourselves. So these are the steps which are very critical. If you see, I put the technical aspect of it, the harvest and implant at the last, because there are 101 things that has to go right in a hair transplant. The technique of harvest and implant is just one part of it. It is just like microvascular surgery, where anastomosis is a technique, but knowing more than that, the selection, everything matters. Similarly, for hair transplant, starting from patient selection, counseling, getting them ready and document them, and giving the proper anesthesia, marking, and then following them, all this makes the hair transplant successful. So my talk will be, just to clarify, it is about the FUV technique of managing androgenetic alopecia. There'll be a pointers which will highlight the science and art behind hair transplant and the lessons that we have been continuously learning over the last 8 to 10 years, which has helped us in forming a comprehensive protocol, which we continue to evolve and update. So one of the first thing when we start off, it is about patient selection. So the routine contraindications, we can find it in any textbooks. What I would like to highlight is, apart from the routine contraindications, any local disease or systemic disease, look out for patients with the gastrointestinal disorders, the patients who are prone for GERD, APD, because these people, we are going to make them lie down in prone or supine position for a long hours. So invariably, they tend to have some amount of nausea, vomiting, or throwing up. And people who have a pre-existing joint problems, neck stiffness, and low back aches, optimize them beforehand. If they have an acute pain, try to get them go for a physiotherapy, postpone the surgery for a few days, and counsel them adequately about this beforehand so that they will be prepared, and give them adequate breaks, stretch before and after, before and during the breaks. So all these small things make a big way in making the patient comfortable, and that also decides your success of your hair transplant. And the literature doesn't give actually smoking as an absolute contraindication, but we have a protocol. There is absolute no smoking for 6 weeks, at least 3 weeks before surgery. If patient smokes, we even cancel the surgery. So this is as good as in any cosmetic surgery. Patient coming with an unrealistic expectations, absolute no towards surgery. Patient who comes with a predetermined mathematical densities with a photograph and he wants to have hairline like this, no, because we can only pay Paul as much as we can borrow from Peter. With this amount of a donor area, we can do a reasonably good job of doing a proper hairline like this. But instead, if the patient wants a hair, a head full of a hair, it will look very patchy. It may not be doing justice to the patient and he may not be a happy patient. So the protocol we have is we never rush for a surgery. We give adequate time. This again, there was talk about, GK sir was highlighting this issue. We have adequate time to prepare the patient before surgery. When I say prepare, it is optimizing the scalp recipient area also with the medical management. That also helps to give a good results in these with the transplant. And this is a time that we take to educate about the hair loss, the nature, the proposed management, the medical part of it, and the need to continue to have a medical management throughout. And because the hair goes in a cycle, be it a medical management or surgical management, ultimately it takes time to see the results. So never bend to patient's whims and fancies. And as Vikram was saying, the very uncommonly we take up the patient early for surgery. Otherwise, we usually schedule them at least 1 to 1.5 months the first visit. We have a protocol, never be seen. So this is how we have our consultation schedule. The first consultation will be all about hair loss, the causes, medical management. The second consultation in those patients who are about to be taken up for transplant. This time between the first and second gives us adequate time to assess the patient also, the psychology, his attitude towards the transplant, and how compliant is about medical management. And this time also helps to strengthen the trust factor that the patient has towards us. And the third consultation, we usually schedule the week before transplant, wherein we discuss about the nuances of hair transplant. So having a documented checklist like this helps a lot. We give this kind of a checklist to the patient so that with each consultation, what needs to be done, and the immediate post-operative and post-op review also. Medical management, as Vikram was talking, we rely mainly on minoxidil and finasteride. And we do PRP. We are documenting it, as we know there are no extensive published reports about PRP. And we harp on nutritional supplements also. Laser light therapy is a good addendum. And before surgery, the patient needs to be counseled properly. There are specific set of instructions that needs to be given to the patient. And we see to that we do it personally. The week before the consultation will be about all this counseling. And the minoxidil, finasteride, everything is stopped 10 days before because the vascularity will be a bit high and it makes surgery a bit cumbersome. And one of the other important things is the hair dye. The patient has a lot of graying of hair. Then we advise him to have a hair dye at least 2 to 3 days before, because it's very difficult to look in the glaring white light and harvest the white hairs. And as I said, we have an absolute no smoking policy. So again, the printed forms like this, where the pre-op and post-op instructions are handed over to the patients. If you see, there is one particular instruction: do not wear t-shirts on the day of surgery. These are something that we learned in a hard way. After having a t-shirt, it's difficult to remove it after the end of to wear it back at the end of the surgery. So this kind of an instruction also includes the tablets that need to be taken the day before, the night before, the morning of the surgery, and when to take food, how much to take food, and be at what time, everything. So apart from reinforcing this personally during the consultation, giving them in hand is also helpful. And we also have a detailed consent form. We normally give this consent form the week before surgery during the counseling session, where we give time for them to go through this and come back with any clarification, and then they sign the consent. With the new CE Act, we are trying to modify it in a way to for the patient themselves to give it in their writing. So on the day of surgery, it is very, very important that we start off early. And the team has to be assembled, because hair transplant involves a team. And each of the team members should know their role play exactly. Over time, they learn to do this properly. And all these charts has to be kept readily for reference, even though over time, the OT staff will learn to do that. And all the PERROC documentation, including the marking and the time of starting harvest, implant, the first hour, second hour, everything, there are fixed charts. And the routine consent taken on the day, and this photography, marking, trimming are also done on the day of surgery by the surgeons themselves. And this is also very important, arranging food and refreshments both for the patient and the team. And the front office should know when to get the food and where to get the food also. So we have charts like this which we put up in the theater, and this helps even in remote areas where we can make any theaters into a HD OT. Having said that, it is not like we can go about doing HD anywhere. But a reasonably good place which we usually see upfront or instruct upfront. This kind of a checklist, we send it off beforehand itself so that they get it ready. So this checklist will have the trolleys to be set up for forenoon, afternoon session for harvest and implant. And on the day, we use trichoscopy mainly for evaluating the donor area and the recipient area. We calculate the square centimeter of the donor area. This and the density of the donor area. So this helps us to spread our harvest so that we can spread it out evenly without taking too much in a smaller area in the donor. And again, in the recipient, beforehand, we can have a assessment about the number of grafts that will be required. And we usually give about 5% to 10% extra considering the transaction. Touch wood, our transaction rates have been less, 2 to 5% at the max, usually around an average of 1 to 2%. But still, it helps better to take a little extra. And photography, the standard photography, it's preferable or rather a must to have it with a digital camera on a tripod. And with the proper white background, a consistent background helps in pre-operative and post-operative comparisons. Photographs like this goes a long way in comparisons later on. So antibiotic prophylaxis, we have a fixed antibiotic of cephalosporin and amikacin. We started combining in the last 2-3 years after the recent mishaps which have been attributed to gram-negative sepsis. It's a class 1 surgery, a clean surgery where there is no contamination from inside, but there is a full thickness skin penetration, and it goes about some at least 3,000 to 5,000 punches being made into the skin. And we routinely advise a patient to shampoo the scalp the night before and on the day of surgery, and we continue with the oral antibiotics. And this is the anesthesia cocktail that we use during surgery. There have been many variations, and we fixed on with this particular solutions. The solution one is the one we use for a ring block, the field block solution, where it's a combination of both lignocaine made it into 0.5% and sensocaine made it into 0.125%. And last two years or so, we started adding soda bicarb also. I'll be kind of talking on that in the next slide. And then solution two, we use for a tumescence in the donor area. This supplements anesthesia. It also helps in harvest. And the delayed block, we use it for donor site towards the end of the procedure so that the patient may have a pain-free night after surgery. So the two important elements in this anesthesia cocktail is vasoconstriction with epinephrine. Previously have been using a premixed lignocaine with epinephrine, and then we found that it is not working out well. The literature also supports and advises to add epinephrine in situ, because the preoperative, premix solution doesn't have that much of an efficacy, and it also stinges at the time of infiltration. And adding 8.5% sodium bicarbonate goes a long way in reducing the infiltrative pain. And this is a bigger factor than even the needle caliber. This has been documented in studies also. And it improves the efficacy of infiltration. And why this infiltration anesthesia is much safer? Because the injections are staged in time and space. We give in the area where we are operating, and then we give it later on in other areas. Like the harvest part, we give the block only in the donor site in the morning, and then the recipient site only in the afternoon. And just like liposuction, this is given in a diluted form. And the higher concentration of epinephrine we use means the systemic absorption, systemic toxicity is practically nil. So apart from that, the solution 2 is also used to supplement in the donor site. So why I've been harping so much about anesthesia is this is the first step in hair transplant. So making the patient comfortable goes a long way for his, ensuring his compliance throughout the procedure. So we supplement this anesthesia with the topical Viveta and Prilox also. And by making use of gait control theory, we can supplement with the vibration and ice. This we have found particularly useful using a vibrator. Even the prick sensation is very, very less. So the field block is given along the lines as marked. It is important that in the donor site, we give it along the line between the occipital protuberance to the mastoid where the occipital nerves emerges out. And in the recipient area, the supraorbital areas, nerves are the most important to be blocked. And we also found that it has to go posteriorly a little bit into the temporal region for an effective block. And this is most important in infiltration anesthesia. The needle need not be advanced. This is a wheel that has to be advanced as we go. The standard dictum of aspiration before injection need not be done because we are giving very micro aliquots of injection. So even if it enters into vascular space, it doesn't cause a systemic toxicity. And we take care very slow injection using a very thin caliber needle. An insulin needle of 30 guards helps. And we give anesthesia itself like 20 to 30 minutes at least. And we should be always prepared for in the eventuality, touch wood, there is no major lignocaine toxicity or anaphylaxis you have seen. But then vasovagal syncopes are a rule rather than an exception, particularly towards the end of the procedure. And as I said, the upper GI disturbances are very common. And though hair transplant is done under local anesthesia and it involves only punches of 0.9 mm or 1 mm, it is still a surgery of a big magnitude. So as plastic surgeons, we are obsessed with sterility and setting up the stage. So drape well, and we use prone position for harvest, and the patient will be counseled well about the positioning and the prolonged hours, and particular care, particular counseling given about bladder and upper GI. Like we always insist that the patient empties his bladder and takes a sip of water and comes down to lie down before harvest or implant. And continuously the patient will be on a monitor, at least a pulse oximeter. And it is better if you are okay with that and patient is okay with that, we can even chat with him during the procedure. That comforts him. And we always have music in theater. And about donor, we never breach the safe donor area. As a rule of thumb, don't go in front of the ears and don't go into the vertex via up and don't go into the nape of neck below. And the most common punch that we use is a 0.9 mm punch. And we use serrated off-late hexagonal punches also. We preferably use a dull punch and we intermix it with the sharp punches also. We use a motorized punch. And we do the cherry picking kind of harvest, like once every 4 or 5 grabs. And because it is done under magnification, the one of the important advantage of FEV is that it gives flexibility to the surgeon to pick the grafts. And it is to be always done under magnification. And this using a light, a cold light, this we have learned in a hard way. When we use a routine theater light in the first few cases, we found the growth was disturbed in one half of the implant where the cold, where the routine light was used. Then when we switched over to the white LED lights, the cold light, the growth was equal on both the sides. So the three important considerations we need to give at the time of harvest is the angle of entry into the skin and the depth of penetration and the pull. So this is something that is given in the books and it is something to be learned with technical practice. And as we harvest simultaneously, the staff will be counting and segregating the graft and they will be storing the graft. The grafts are stored in sequences. We use this kind of boxes for cold storage and it will be labeled as a first hour, second hour, third hour, fourth hour grafts. And we always make sure that the staff are also trained to handle all the grafts under magnification. So this is the part where the staffs are involved. Other than this, counting, segregating and loading the needles, most of the other handling will be by the surgeons. That is one way of ensuring results, keeping the injury to the grafts as minimum as possible. And going on to the marking, never go too low into the forehead. The forehead is a place where there should not be any hairs. The plane where the forehead and scalp meets, that is where the hairline should start. And it's preferable to err towards keeping it a little back rather than front, because once you commit a front hairline, it is very difficult to fill it up later on. And in case a patient has a progressive hair loss, which is invariably the case with androgenetic alopecia, it will look very ugly down the years to come. There will be a patch of baldness in between the two. And it is always, you can always fill it up in front later on. And try to give a natural look as well, hairline irregularity. And we always prefer to fill up the frontal tuft first and the two supratemporoparietal humps. And then we go to the mid scalp. Off late, we try to give a full coverage as much as possible. As we are into a changing of a concept of reducing the density. I'll be talking on that a bit later. So this is our first preference area, and then we give a good hump here and take care to fill up a small fringes in this, and then giving this area. Why this is important is, and this kind of a gadget helps in marking easy. Okay, I'll talk about that later. The implant, coming on to the implant technique, we use needle implant because we got used to it, but the slit technique has got its own advantages and it saves a lot of time also. So one of the important advantages, multiple operators can put in the graft, and we go by sequential implant. The first harvested grafts will go in. We keep a time scale of 4 to 6 hours, minimum of, I mean, within 4 hours, the graft will go in back into the body. That is the dictum that we follow. And we both, two surgeons, we are trained to use our left hand. So that gives an advantage that we can do the right and left side simultaneously. And both of us do around the same speed. So that also helps us to improvise on table, giving a differential fill between the right and left or an equal fill. And the most important technical consideration when it comes to implant is the angle of implant. Once we get technically adept on that, we can avoid a lot of issues with the pop-outs and bleeding. Also, again, we as we go, we tend to improvise our own techniques of arresting the bleeding. And we don't tumus the recipient area. There are a few concepts of using tumescence in recipient area for increasing the surface area as well as the anesthesia purpose. The anesthesia, especially in the recipient side, tends to wear off, but we prefer to supplement with another ring block, second hour or third hour, rather than tumescence, because we found without tumescence, the popping out is a bit less. That is with our kind of technique. And as the dictum, the single hair units are usually put in the front in the hairline, and the second and two and three follicular units are put in the back. And it is very, very important to remember there is only a limited number of permanent hairs we have in the donor area. So it has to be used wisely. So as I said, the density, initially we started doing like 45 units per square centimeter. But then the international consensus is anything beyond 30 follicular units per square centimeter need not be done, because the more crowded also causes more ischemia, the chances of graft loss is more. And to give a satisfactory cosmetic result, 30 is more than adequate, because it takes at least 50% of a follicular unit loss in an area to make it as a visible hair loss. So this is what I was telling. So make use of whatever available in the donor site and fill it up properly, going up to the mid scalp, so that in the front, when you see...
Dr. Rajendran, I think we have, he has a... Sir, I think we have lost Dr. Rajendran's net connection. Dr. Ramji, sir?
Yes.
While he's getting back, could you handle some of the questions here, sir, in the chat box? There is one question. Possible use of this local anesthesia cocktail. I don't know. Bupivacaine 0.5%, 20 ml. Lignocaine 2%, 10 ml. Normal saline 10 ml. Adrenaline 2 drops. Methylene blue 1 ml. Can it be improvised?
Karthikeyan, I think choice of local anesthetic agents are the personal choices. I don't use anything other than xylocaine. I don't even use sensorcaine. I don't use anything else.
Okay.
And I've never used any other product for, I think I did my first transplant in 86. And since then, I have never used any other product except xylocaine, and it works very well with me.
Okay.
So I don't think I'll be able to answer about the use of combining it with other products, because sometimes I feel the more drugs you mix, the chances are that you may exceed the dosage of any one, or they may react with each other and produce some situations which are unpleasant.
Yes, sir. Yes. We have Dr. Venkat Tota with us from Hyderabad. Good evening, sir. Sir, Dr. Venkat Tota, sir. Okay. Dr. James, sir, what
yes.
is your take on the local anesthetic, the use of local anesthetic?
In my limited practice of air transplant, I use only lignocaine. I have not used bupivacaine.
Dr. Roy?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you also feel, do you feel that the requirement for combinations is not an absolute must?
Definitely. We can go on supplementing or just add lignocaine. So that makes the, procedure simple, and I don't find it necessary to use long-acting local anesthetics.
Absolutely. I think it follows the KISS principle, which all of us believe in, keeping things simple.
Yeah.
And I think the single local anesthetic agent is good enough, as far as I found, in terms of pain relief and also in terms of longevity. I feel it works even for 8-9 hours. I have not experienced or required any other supplementation except topping up. And in fact, I found that even at the end of the surgery, there was still a fair amount of local still remaining.
Yeah. That's very true. Even in liposuction, the basic combination of simple lignocaine does the job very well.
Absolutely.
Sir, Dr. James, sir, you have posted a comment. Most of our patients ask for a low hairline, but it's not accepted. Is it technical reason of less number of grafts? Any study or trial to lower? What do you feel, sir?
That is what I ask juniors when they do the air transplant. They keep refusing. The patients ask for a low hairline. So what is, see, the fixed hairline, all these 4 fingers, 7 centimeter, all these things are established by European or Western standards. So our people like a low hairline. Why not we try? I keep telling Vikram, you just try to suit our or balance our Indian standards. People ask for it. Why don't you try?
Dr. Ramji, sir, what is your take on that? Low hair?
Yeah, see, I think we have to look into all aspects. How good the donor area is. How strong is the family history? How old is the patient? What is his requirement? I think you can't just generalize. And there are exceptions. So if you say that the average age at which you operate is around 23 or 24, in a very rare situation, I've operated in a young patient who is probably 18, not a real candidate. But the reason was he was not going to continue his studies. So there are certain situations where we have to take a call. But the thing to remember is that the donor density is limited. The donor site is limited. And so if you start with a low hairline, we must remember that we will exhaust the graphs before we are able to do a good coverage. That's the only thing that we have to remember. Hair planting can be done in any area, it will grow. The thing to remember is, if we start at 23 and we start with a low hairline, if he progresses in the next 2-3 years because of a very strong family history and he does not have enough reserves, then we may have a situation where he is traveling with a band-like amount of hair, very low, which looks unnatural for his age. So that is the only thing that we need to look into. Second thing I have to point out is, especially because the topic covered is FUE, and of course, Dr. Rajendran, he is doing a good job in the coverage, but since strip was not mentioned, I'm taking this time to talk about one of the problems with FUE is many times we are violating the safe donor area, as I've seen in the pictures that were presented. As you know, the safe donor area is relatively safe. What is safe at 25 to 30 years, as the person ages, say he becomes 30 or he becomes 35, the donor area starts coming down, especially in the midline. So we can go a little higher to the periphery, the fringes, but definitely the area in the midline, the occipital region, we have to be very careful, because many times most of the people, in the attempt to harvest more, and especially since you are going to leave one graft and leave about 2 or 3 in between, and again the need to compete with more grafts, invariably the violation of the safe donor site takes place. Two things happen. One is, of course, the scars may not be that visible even if the patient balds. Even if the donor area scars get exposed, I would say that may not be a major issue. But one of the things that happens is the hair start to fall very quickly in the transplanted region because they are under the influence of the DHT. So if you are going to harvest higher up or lower down towards the nape of the neck, both the things are issues. You'll find that the gain is temporary, but after 2 years, there have been standing examples of patients who continue losing their hair because they have been removed from outside the safe zone. So the importance of the strip surgery now is the strip technically takes from the best spot or the sweet spot of the donor area. You know, in every situation, if you take a racket or a cricket bat, there is a sweet spot. So even in the safe donor area, there is a sweet spot which gives you the best hairs, and that is right in the middle. And you can say just below the external occipital protuberance or just around that. So that is going to remain the longest, and that will be, you can say, more or less permanent, or for the hair to fall in that area is going to take a long, long time. So this is, and especially if the hair, the scalp is lax, the donor area is lax, then my first choice would still be a strip surgery, and we can get very decent scars with that. I am not a proponent of only strip or FUE. For your information, I was probably one of the earliest people among the older group to switch over and accept FUE as a good method. And in fact, we were one of the earliest people to form a society for FUE, which had its own issues, but that's a separate topic altogether. But the thing to remember is the safe donor site, and that we have limited reserves, but trying to use other areas like beard, and third option is body hair, is definitely opening up more avenues for FUE.
Okay, sir.
So I've transgressed the topic which we started off with, the low hairline, but I would say that I have to keep these options. And of course, when you are in practice for a longer time, you can afford to be a little more authoritative to the patient and probably refuse if they insist on a low hairline. The reason being that it may end up in a situation where it starts looking ugly in the future. It's not that there's no other issue, but if you are very confident about the progression, if you're very confident that you will produce good results, I think it can be done as an exception.
Yeah, thank you, sir. I think Dr. Rajendran is back. I think he continues his discussion after the half-finished presentation, sir. Dr. Rajendran, are you ready?
Sir, sorry, there was a power breakup and it so happened Murphy's Law today of all the days. It was a major one and our block was the only one that was left out. Okay. Sorry about that. Can I continue with this?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay. So, about the graft survival, there are so many literature about whether a thin graft or a thick graft, which does well and all these things. And the density, as I discussed, putting too many grafts closer together is also not good. And the temperature, the time the graft stays outside of the body and the storage, the temperature during the entire process, all these things matters. But the two most important things that we found is the follicular unit injury, the amount of injury that it sustains during the entire process, and the dehydration. Keeping it moist helps. And the recipient vascularity, the preparing the recipient bed with a good amount of medical management helps a lot. If you notice, I have put down the expertise of the surgeon as a last among these factors, because as plastic surgeons, we are adept in learning the learning curve with respect to technique is a bit easy, but where we lose out is especially with hair transplant, as TC sir was saying. There are so many other things than just technique which has to go right for the transplant. So knowing the concept behind this and giving attention to all these details helps a lot. So in the post-operative period, immediately we give a good compression dressing for the donor side, whereas for the recipient side, we usually allow it to be left open, and we advise the patient to keep it moist and clean for the first 3 days. We call back the patient on the third day and give them a good wash and demonstrate them how to take care by themselves. And after third day, we usually call them back after 1 week or so, first week, 10th day. Post-operative course, most of our patients have not complained of pain. It's usually a tolerable amount of a headache, mainly because of the tumescence that is being infiltrated. It usually settles well with just a paracetamol. And invariably, they have some amount of paresthesia and hyposthesia in the occipital region. Especially, previously, we were using rings to support the head during the implant. And this has caused a specific area of hyposthesia within the ring. So we have given up that and we start using a small pillow and blankets. And edema is particularly more so because I tend to tumus a lot in the donor area rather than my colleagues. So I prefer tumused area for harvest. And crusting, when the it's pretty much common that the patient complains of some amount of itching in the first, second and third day due to the crust that is formed. And most importantly, the patient will have questions regarding the return to work, bath, exercise, and when to restart the medical management and all this. This has to be properly counseled to them upfront, even before they ask. So this is these are some usual post-operative course that we see with our patients. The edema is a common thing and some sterile folliculitis. And the follow-up photographs are very, very important, because this is one of the better follow-up, because the patient is a doctor who can take the photograph serially and send it across in the proper time. And using a standard photographs for follow-up with the proper background helps in documentation. And sometimes we go out of the way, and when the patients don't come by themselves for follow-up, we even search them in Facebook and get this. And we had a bit of discussion about ergonomics. So this is very important, because like any other prolonged plastic surgery, hair transplant is something where repetitive, monotonous work is being done, where the entire focus and concentration is on a single narrow field of 4 centimeter diameter under an intense glaring light. So we tend to forget about our neck, back and joint position. So it is very imperative that the appliances, the mechanical tools take care of our back and neck. So I just pulled a pillow to support my elbow right now also. So it has become a second hand nature to make sure the ergonomics are right. I think most of our plastic surgeons should be obsessed. Unless we have a proper sit and make ourselves comfortable, we cannot do justice to the procedure also. So for the surgeon, we have finally narrowed down to using this ophthalmology examination chair, where we use the backrest of the chair as a elbow rest. And we have a small modification to give in the back for our lower back support. The important thing is the chair has to be of an adjustable height. The same goes with the theta table also. This is a massage chair that we have started using on and off. We regularly use this for anesthesia, for giving the donor side block. And this is a very, very comfortable position for the patient. In fact, the entire procedure, harvest, implant, everything can be done with this chair, but it's very difficult for a surgeon to do this because we need to be in a standing position. This absolutely, it's not charming for the surgeon to stand throughout for 9 to 10 hours. We use this particular chair mainly for anesthesia and for vertex implant because it helps for us to go around and do a vertex implant with this. And this is something that we have improvised over a theater table. We have got away with the routine theater table. We started using this massage cart as a standard operating table for hair transplant. The advantage is it's a very broad cart, so the patient can have their hands tucked in beneath their sides, or they can keep it in the ledge here for a support, and it has got a separate head ring. And it also helps in the supine position also because it can be given a 30-degree head propped up position, and this can be folded and kept aside also. So the day before transplant, the night before, we open up and keep it inside the theater, and then we fumigate the room and the theater is ready for transplant. So the take home message, as I said in the first slide, there are critical steps, and all these critical steps has to be done only by the surgeon. This is a very key component of hair transplant to make it successful. And there are so many learning curves, so many learning things, like so many nuances that you need to keep on improvising, educate yourself and train your team and give a meticulous attention to details. There, as I said, there are 101 things that need to be right for a successful outcome. And training your team to align with your thought process, with your frequency is very important. When we say they have to handle it in a gentle way, and they have to hold the graft here only the in a particular way, they need to know why it is important. And as in any field, we have to keep updating our technical expertise and improvise. As plastic surgeons, we have an edge over the physician counterparts because we can improvise and innovate. So in spite of remuneration, whether it is lucrative or not, is a different question. This is one of the procedures that is that will kindle a passion to such a degree everyone for a patient is. Hello.
Yes, sir. Ramji, sir.
Yeah.
Hello. Sir, yes, sorry. I'm not sure if the presentation was gone throughout, or is there any connections issues in between?
No, we have seen the entire presentation.
Thank you.
The last one or two slides, the last few seconds only was a little what, but otherwise it came through clearly. Dr. Ramji, sir, you are.
Yeah. I think very well presented. I must acknowledge that the topic has been well covered. I have discussed a few points, but I think I'll probably have to elaborate on a few more. Of course, you must remember that the hair transplant surgeons among the plastic fraternity is a much smaller group as compared to your counterparts, the so-called dermato surgeons, who are ruling the roost now. So they are probably, I don't know, maybe 1,000 times more in number. I wouldn't even know what is the, we may be 300 or 400 and they may be 10,000 because every dermatologist claims that he or she is a surgeon. So, but one thing is to the group, I don't know the number of people who are attending. I think as plastic surgeons, we still have to keep strip and FUE as options. decision making should be based not on knowing one procedure. We have the advantage of knowing both or capacity to do both. I'm not saying this because I started with STRIP. Unfortunately, I did not. I started with the big FUE, as you can call it. They are plugs. I used the motorized punch in 1986 at the size of about 4 mm. And then if you see the evolution of hair transplant in my journey, it went from that, it became 3 mm, it became 2 mm. Then I went to STRIP, then I went to micro dissection, and then back to FUE. So I've seen the entire gamut of things which were happening, including free flap of a jury type, crossed free flap to reverse the growth. So all the things have been done. Now, why I'm pointing out is, if I see a patient with definite crown thinning, with a history of hair loss and a definite crown thinning, I would say that the donor area is definitely going to be violated very quickly if you are going to do FUE. So if I feel that there is significant crown thinning and the activity is good, and the chances are that the donor area is going to be much lower than what it is at present, I would still suggest a strip surgery, because most of the FUE surgeries go beyond the safe donor site. The marking itself is many times incorrect, and we presume that the hair loss will not progress to that. And I explained to you, if you harvest from that area, especially in the midline, much above the occipital region, as has been shown in many other lectures too, those hairs are bound to be lost. So this is probably the single most important point against FUE, is violating the donor area, telling that we are harvesting from in a good area, but it is certainly above the safe zone. So if I find that there is thinning in the crown, and if I feel that it is going to go further down, then I would probably look at a strip and harvest from a little lower down, which is relatively safer. That is one. Second thing is holding solutions. I think each one to his own. There are people who hold in PRP, there are people who hold it in chill saline. I think it is your own usage. The two things to remember is IRI, that is ischemia related injuries. The longer the graft is outside the body, the chances are that you're going to have this problem. So the effluvium will be more. Sometimes the take of the graft will be more. So, I mean, the damage to the graft will be more. So one of the things that could be done is even reducing the 4-hour period. You could probably harvest, implant, and then reharvest, or you could drill, leave behind, not remove it from the bed, and then pull it out afterwards if you're doing FUE. That means you drill 2,000 grafts or 2,500 grafts, but you pull out about 1,000 and leave the remaining in situ. And once you've harvested the entire, you've transplanted the first 1,000, then you can go back and pull the grafts out. This way, you will still have the grafts remaining in the scalp. This is one way to reduce IRI. The third thing is about the RSS, that is the repetitive stress syndrome. Most of the plastic surgeons who do hair transplant will be facing this. It is not only a question of neck pain and shoulder pain. Your intrinsics and lumbricals and the finger joints are at a tremendous stress. So you must be in a position to do a lot of physical exercise and activities related to neck, shoulder, body, finger. So you must be physically fit to perform this type of a surgery. Longer bursal surgery is one issue, but the physical stamina and the ability to do this is can be improved with good physical fitness. So it is very important to do this, especially for people who do the entire surgery yourself. The point about technicians is well taken. Being a past president of AHRS and also the ISHRS guidelines suggest that we relegate the role of technicians to what is the bare minimum. They should not come in direct contact with the patient in terms of incision making, harvesting, which is in gross violation. They can probably at best do implantation in a patient where the pre-made slits have been made. But I would still suggest that if you're able to do all these things yourself, nothing like it, because the pleasure of seeing the hair grow when you have done it yourself is much more than having a gardener doing something and then you see a few flowers here and there. That is not, I mean, anybody can do that. But when you see your results, you feel happy about it. When the patient brings a wedding card after the transplant because of you, he has become an eligible bachelor or he gets married, that brings more happiness than having 10 people whom you have borrowed or hired or in brackets stolen, whatever be it. I think these are points to be known because this is an open forum where I have to mention such things are happening. So please don't violate these norms. Learn the tricks, learn the technique and try to do it the way it should be done rather than any of the shortcuts. So another important thing which I already mentioned was use of combination of local anesthetics. I prefer to use only xylocaine. I do not mix it. I feel that it is good enough to last. And as I had mentioned, I think Dr. Rajendran was missing during that period when we are discussing. I still have a fair amount of local remaining. I dilute, go on diluting it. I use and I dilute so that at a certain point, you don't need that much. You may need a top up. You must have a team for resuscitation. That is the most important thing. Because if you're doing in a standalone center, many times people will say, I get an anesthetic when I'm giving the local anesthesia. I think problems are not at that time. In fact, if you have an anesthetist, when you're trying to give some pain relief for the sake of local, I think there are more problems because of that, because they may give you a little bit more and the patient will not cooperate. If they give a little bit less, it doesn't help. So it is better to prepare the patient mentally that this is one small step in your journey. Difficulties are there. There are people who are handicapped who have climbed Everest. So if you are interested in hair, it's a small price to pay to bear a little bit of pain. So once you tell them this, they will be able to withstand. So major sedation is not necessary. I give them an Alprax, half an Alprax before the surgery, so that most of the time they sleep, especially during the first 2 hours. But important point is, you can have an event anytime. So especially vasovagal is something which you should be prepared for. It's more of a panic situation, but again, if there is nobody to help, yeah, it can be a crisis. So this is something you must know how to handle. Either you should be capable of handling, or you are trained to do this, you know, body resuscitation, whatever you have done, the critical care resuscitating techniques, you're familiar with it by going through courses or being practically trained, or you must have somebody to handle this because this is a surgery which could take 6 hours. You must know how to have somebody around for that period. It may not happen anytime during a lifetime. It could happen in somebody's lifetime. And that time, if it's a loss, you will not be able to come out of it. Unfortunately, I have been in a hospital setup. So, I mean, that's all I can see. If you say unfortunately, yes. But fortunately, I've always had an anesthetist in some theater or the other. So I would not have the situation where I don't have help. So this is something you should have because instances have happened where patients have collapsed. So some of them reported, many of them go unnoticed. So this is something we come to know through, you know, when there is a private talk, such a thing has happened. So you should know how to handle it. Other than that, I think you have covered almost everything. Hiccup, I don't know whether anybody has encountered hiccup during your practice. If you have not, you're sure to see it sometime or the other. And that is usually because of gastric irritation. So you, when you encounter that for the first time, you will find that the patient says, I have been having incessant hiccup from morning. Don't panic. You have to increase the dosage of your antacids. I usually put them on steroids to reduce swelling, but I will immediately stop steroids and then I will use more of paracetamol for pain relief. You will have to give them a fair amount of Gelosil or such stuff, maybe every 2 hours, and then you must put them on Domstol. So if you have not encountered hiccup, you will find that it comes sometime in your career, you will definitely see it. But so remember that it is something due to diaphragmatic irritation. So I think I've covered most of the things. A very good presentation, but I would like to point out to, as a senior, I would like to point out, Rajendran, you have to take care of your spellings, because it's a presentation. This may be a small group. You're going to go much higher. You're going to present nationally, internationally. Spelling mistakes are something which I will not accept. There are probably best paper presentation, no spellings and all that. I think it is something which you should check. Make sure that even if your secretary or somebody else is doing it, the onus is on you to make sure that you have gone through the presentation and seen that the spell check is done. If you are not comfortable, you must seek help, because too many errors in spelling, a person like me probably, some of the teachers have a very nasty habit of always pointing out where there is a mistake, because the eye is like that. All the good points are brushed off because you know it's correct. You know, an examiner is always like that. He somehow has a habit of picking something which you don't know. It's not that he does it deliberately, but he has a habit. So don't take it in the wrong sense. I would suggest that pay attention to your presentation, because it's your frontage. So I think I've covered most of the things. Kartik, if there's anything else you want, or maybe you could go to the chat section and ask questions, whatever has been presented.
Yeah. First, there are three sections, sir. One is somebody had raised a hand. I just want to see. I think Dr. Venkat Tota had raised his hand. If he's there, he can ask the question. I'll just read out the other questions in the chat box. The thing is, one question was about the local anesthetic. What is the total local anesthesia solution given at one time, since the area is big, from Dr. Alexander George? Is Dr. Rajendran answering that?
Yeah, he could answer, then I will see what I can do. Yeah.
Normally, for a donor site, the concentration that, as I said, it is about 0.5% of lignocaine. We use about 13 ml of 2% lignocaine with 13 ml of sensorkine, 0.5%, and make it up to another 26 ml with RL. So it comes to 1/4 of the concentration. This mixture comes to about 52 ml, of which normally anywhere around 20 ml goes into the donor site block and the recipient site block in the afternoon. So normally we prepare a solution in the morning, and I give a ring block anywhere from 20 to 25 ml usually goes in at the first time. And donor site, most of the times you are not come across of topping up as frequently as required when compared to recipient side. And what we have learned the other thing is we always prepare a fresh solution for the afternoon session for the implant. We don't use the remaining solution from the morning. And again, in the afternoon session, out of the 52, usually around 20 ml goes in for the first block. In fact, for the recipient side, usually it's much lesser. But then most often the recipient side will require some amount of topping up after second hour or third hour. But invariably we get away anywhere around 28 to 35 ml max. That is for an entire procedure with this solution. And the solution to the tumescence that goes into the donor block, that usually seeps out with the punches itself. And before handing over to Ramji, sir, sorry about the spelling mistakes. Actually, it's news to me, and I only prepared the slides. I'll go back and check the presentation. I think I missed out a lot of spelling mistakes. I did so many editing in the last minute, so probably...
forced and unforced errors are there. So you'll have to check on that and see. Because as I told you, this is... you're in the beginning, and you're going to present in many meetings, national and internationally. So whenever you present, the quality of presentation is important, and spell check. And in fact, Dr. Bose is a stickler. I think anybody who has been with Dr. Samsi Bose will know that he is a stickler for this. Even though I have not been a direct student. I keep him as my mentor in many ways. I mean, as a person, as a human being, in so many ways. And that is one thing I always say, that, you know, he's a stickler for pronunciation as well as spell check. Okay, with regard to the local, I've already mentioned I don't mix anything. And the block for the front, I usually keep 5 mils of 2% xylocaine with adrenaline. That is the standard. And that is what I use for the block, for the supraorbital, supratrochlear. I use about 3 mils in the first go, and then 2 mL is still remaining, and that will go as a top-up maybe 2 hours down the line, as you're mentioning. The other solution which I prepare is 25 mils of 2% xylocaine, to which we add 75 mL of normal saline, and then 1 ampule of adrenaline. And this is what we use for the donor area. So it is not a standard solution, it's a prepared solution. The third thing is, we don't have a morning session, afternoon session. As I told you, in a place like Apollo, we cannot afford to have a break. So it is one go, starting from the beginning to the end, because every minute in the theater that you breathe air in the theater, it is money that you're paying. So there is nothing like I spent time in marking, or I just wasted time. Everything is documented on CCTV, patient in, what time patient was inside the theater, what time the patient came out is how the charges are made for the theater. So we cannot afford to waste any time. So I am in and I don't have a break, and I finish 6 hours, 7 hours, 8 hours. If the patient wants a toilet break, I do give it, but I tell them to be very brief, and I tell them that when I am not using it, you probably will have to make sure that you also don't waste your time, because your charges go up. So we keep it straight in one go. We don't prepare two solutions. It's one solution. And what I've made for the donor area, as it gets used, same thing can be used for the recipient. We go on diluting and over diluting. So as I told you, a fair amount of it still remains. I never had the need to use any other supplementation for this. Of course, an IV line is extremely important. I'm sure you would have mentioned about it. But more than anything, I do have an anesthetist who is hanging around somewhere in one of the theaters.
Sir, the next question is, any experience using posture corrector brace or kinesiology tapes for better ergonomics for the operating surgeon?
So far, we have not used any add-ons like this. But I've been improvising this operating chair. This is about some sixth chair or something that we have modified. Previously, it was like two arms coming from this side and can fold open for the elbow rest. All these were custom-made chairs where the backrest, the concept was we always had a good amount of a backrest and a good elbow rest and height adjustable chairs. Thank God so far we have not come into a stage where we require that kind of an add-ons for our comfort. And we got to some extent, yes, as the day goes, we have some bearing on pain or some kind of stiffness, but we got used to it, and as Star was saying, we do give some attention to fitness also. So incidentally, cycling and running has been my passion, and it helps the other way also, that endurance training physically and mentally helps to stay focused for the entire duration with a single job. Like, as I said, it's unlike even a microvascular surgery. This is something like a same job that you have to do repeatedly over a long period of time. So it requires more of a mental endurance also, apart from physical endurance.
I think we can mention here, Doctor, that Dr. Rajendran is a half marathoner and a cyclist also, avid cyclist. So anyway, the next question is view on robotic hair transplant from Dr. Gigi Raj.
Shall I answer or is it for
Ramji? Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. robotic transplant, I mean, whatever we have read only, obviously there is no hand-on experience. As of now, the Arthas robot that has come up, it has not matched human hands so far. The Arthas robot, still the transaction rates is high, and it is being still under evolutionary stages. But artificial intelligence is coming in a big way, so the machine can definitely learn a lot faster. Maybe within a decade also, we may see a big change. But one thing is, it can never replace the human element, the marking and the art of a transplant. It's very difficult for a machine to learn. Maybe the science they can perfect. They can make the topography mapping and harvest thing perfect. But still, I mean, my personal opinion is can never replace a surgeon. The art and technicality part of that surgeon has to play. And the other thing that I read up is the ergonomics, because we are talking about that, the chair that has been designed for the Arthas is not so conducive. Like it puts the patient under so much of strain. I saw a photograph of the chair, but I mean, I've not seen it in working. So maybe Ramji sir will have a better idea.
Personally, I would say, especially for a country like India, it may not be viable financially. Second thing is, the punch size is close to probably 1 mm and or maybe a little less now. It's not useful for harvesting from other sites like beard and body, because we depend on those areas now. Definitely not cost effective. And I think probably one of the best things in that equipment is the one, they have a thing which stretches the scalp. There is a device which actually puts the scalp under tension, which is probably very crucial, which will make a lot of, if you get that, it may help you to tense the scalp very easily, but it's not available. It's a part of the equipment. It is like a distractor, which has got four claws, and then it fixed, it is stretched and put. So it puts a lot of tension on the scalp. So that is one thing. I would say it's probably, at this stage, I would not recommend it as a procedure or an equipment to be invested on. But if you ask me how a businessman could invest, this is my thought. If you're going to have a center where you're going to keep this, and you're going to say, bring your patient and I will harvest for 2 hours, and then you take him back and do whatever you want in the next theater on the next theater. So in that case, you may be able to harvest on 4 or 5 people, and then it may become viable. But if you're going to own one and then you're going to do it only on your patient, it's very unlikely that you'll be able to generate a revenue on that.
There is the next question, sir, is from Dr. Alexander George. What is the normal inter-hair distance that you maintain while implanting?
This is, I cannot say exactly the fraction of a millimeter, but as I said, it is the density that we go about. Initially, we were implanting about 40 follicular units per square centimeter, and after it, we have started reducing it to around 30. And the way we do it is, the initial stages, when we wanted to give the exact density that we planned, the recipient area, we marked 1 into 1 centimeter square squares within the recipient area, in the front a little packed, as we go behind a little sparse, and then we calculate the number of grafts that goes into each of those squares. So over a period of time, it becomes an hand-eye coordination to know the rough density that we do. And when we started to voluntarily reduce the density also, we went back to the same technique. Like, we started marking out, and then we made sure that we put only 32 grafts within a centimeter square. And it's actually difficult to unlearn close packing, but it can be done. So, I mean, I cannot give that fraction millimeter exactly to be done, but the density that we prefer is anywhere around 30 to 32 or maximum 35.
Sir, there are two questions in the private chat. One is, opinion about artificial hair, biofiber for hair transplant?
I would probably say no. Not advisable, because there are lots of issues with that, and many of these are not even FDA approved. So you will have repeated infections, and then it's a very difficult thing to pull it out. Sometimes the base of it gets stuck. If for some reason you have used it along with the existing hair and you go for a haircut, God forbid, that also will go. So I remember one episode where a patient has had this, and he came with a head injury to the emergency and he was shaved. So everything went with that. But I'm just giving you an example. So, but it's not advisable because it's not something which is worthwhile.
And there is another question. How was the modification of your procedure of hair transplant in this COVID times?
Yes, I think it's a very valid question. For plastic surgeons and dermatologists, I think the difference is a little less for us. For people who used to don a pair of gloves and sometimes wear a mask and do, if that is the group, a lot of changes have to be done. But if it's a plastic surgeon who's doing hair transplant, I presume he is following the basic steps, which includes gloving, close gloving, wearing a face mask. Now, here what we are doing is we are using a double mask. So one is COVID mask and the other one is on top of that. Whether it's absolutely necessary or not, sometimes we feel fear factor. Even though we do a COVID test, the important thing is to make sure that you do a COVID test 2 days before, wait for the result, next day when the report comes, and then you go for the surgery. Make sure that the patient is in isolation during that 2 day period. And it's a complete gloving, two sets of gloves, which we normally wear, so there's no difference in that. Eye shield, if you're not wearing, you need to wear that. And the leggings, that is something which is all right. You can cover yourself. And in the theater, fortunately, they suggest no recycling of air. And in our theater, fortunately, we have a scavenging system, which probably was designed for something else, in the sense that I don't think they expected COVID. So they had designed it. And so there is no recycling of air. The entire air goes through the HEPA filter and goes out. So that is another plus point. They otherwise suggest that there should be, the door should be kept open and reduce aerosol. And that is a very important thing, because FUE produces more aerosol than strip surgery. So you have anybody who's going to do FUE has to be very careful, because the aerosol is there. But even though the basic aerosol that is problematic is from the nasopharynx, tomorrow somebody should not tell that it is, because each day somebody comes and tells, you know, today they say that it's only nasopharynx. Somebody says it is found in feces. Somebody may tell it comes through the blood. So these things have to be put in the right perspective. And the most important thing is patient has to wear a mask when he's in surgery. So some of them will find it difficult. So we have to tell them that this is the thing. And the third thing is, if you're going to harvest from the beard, it becomes a little sensitive issue, because the patient has to unmask and do. So you have to be careful. So these are the things. So maybe I would probably go for a body hair rather than going directly for the beard. I do ask them to have masks. We tell them to have a good gargle with betadine 1 day prior, to make sure that, you know, at least 2 or 3 times betadine gargle. So these are some of the changes that we have made in local anesthesia. Of course, GA is a completely different thing, but all the theater sisters, they are all told to maintain the same thing. So gowning and everything was all the same, only the double mask and the eye shields are more.
And there is one more question from Dr. James, sir. He's asked, what is your opinion about doing 400 to 500 grafts a day in 2 hours and completing in 4 to 5 days? He says he has come across the system in Iran and Turkey.
I don't know what would be the reason for 500 grafts, because I don't think anybody would like to have repeated local every day, because the worst part of the surgery is going to be that. So, and I doing two sessions of maybe 2,500, 3,000 graphs and on one day, and then another 1,000 graphs from another body side, because when we use body hair, this amount of local is not good enough. We need to actually tumes it. When we do chest harvesting, we actually do it like a tumes, like a lipo. So we need to have more local. So we would like to spread it. Doing the scalp in one day, maybe scalp and a little bit of beard, and then going for the body on another day where you need more local. But I can't imagine why somebody would do only 400, 500 grafts, because unless there is any other reason, I don't think the local is going to be very pleasant for 4 days. And 2 hour surgery, unless there is some reason where either the surgeon is not comfortable or the patient is not comfortable, more than 2 hours, only Dr. Roy can probably tell what could be the reason.
Yeah. Maybe I'm audible?
Yes.
Yeah. When I was in Kuwait, people used to make a trip, 1 week trip to Iran. Tourists, 2 hours in a center, just do a 400, 500, or depending upon the. They don't stay for more than 2 hours in the OR. And they go out for shopping and everything. They finish and come back in 1 week. Few patients I interacted, they found it very, you know, less tiring, less troublesome. So maybe the Iran, the Middle East, this kind of practice is going on in Iran and few centers in Turkey. Both the surgeon is not tired, the patient is also not tired.
There is one question from the YouTube stream. One Dr. Phobin Varghese has asked the question, please let me know a reasonable number of units that can be grafted in one sitting.
I think it's a very vague question, because each one will have a different answer. So it would depend upon how much you are able to do. But don't go into the league where somebody says that, you know, I put 4,000 grafts in one go. So don't attempt that. So it depends on where you are starting. As I told you earlier, when I started in 1986, I put around 30 grafts. But I can't say that I will do that now. So that we cannot do. So I think a minimum, if it's a hairline area, if it's a very small area, we have to still look at about 1,000 grafts. That would be something, I think, less than that. It could be for a scar alopecia. It could be for a lip. Yes, there are some situations where the number of grafts will be less. But more or less for these areas where even if you're doing a hairline, which is a very small recession, you may still need about 1,000 or 1,500. Lesser than that would be specific indications. But just jumping into the stream and trying to say that I'm going to do a large area and do remove large number of grafts is not advisable. Just like in a lipo, if somebody says I'm going to do 10 liters, I would say be careful. One, may not be the right indication. Two, may not be advisable. So this is how I put it. So there are certain guidelines. So learn the technique, see how your local effect wears, see how you can harvest, whether you have help, whether you have a team. So based on that, you do that. I mean, we can't have a rule of thumb and say that you can do 2,500. And so the next day the person says, okay, somebody has told in the discussion 2,500. So that should be the target. No, if you're a beginner, make sure that you take the steps, make sure you take the right help, choose the area. Supposing it is a post-burn scar, and then you know that the patient understands that the vascularity may not be good, you may be able to start with smaller number of grafts. But if you're going to do a scalp, I would say very, very small areas may still need about 1,000 grafts. So that would be my way of assessing what would be the requirement.
Okay, sir. Just one more question from Dr. Alexander George in the chat box. Any comment on the use of combining pigment tattooing with hair implants?
Yeah, that is SMP, as they call it, scalp micropigmentation. It definitely would be of help when there is a very large area and you have done hair transplant and you want to put a pigment in between the grafts. It would be definitely a useful area. Another area where it has been used is for the donor area of a strip scar if it has widened. Again, scalp micropigmentation has been used. But supposing you're not doing a surgery and you are going to put only scalp micropigmentation for the entire area which is exposed, I think in close range it is visible. And when the pigment fades, it is more obvious. So since the question is intermingling, I would say yes, thumbs up. But if it is an isolated procedure by itself in a bald area, I think it is a giveaway.
Okay, sir. And there is just one more just to complete it. Is there any practice which will change permanently after this COVID with respect to hair transplant?
So many things are changing.
Permanently, they want to know. Dr. Venkat.
One of the things is, you know that patients will not be traveling big distances, at least for the time being. So most of them will be from your area. Probably the next option may be from neighboring areas or maybe from the city. Then as it opens up, it may be from the periphery or from the districts. So this is going to be a major change. Of course, as you know that, you know, some of the people are having problems with economy. Many of us have. Similarly, patients will also have. Some of them wanted to get it done. Even the plus side was people thought it's a holiday. People didn't realize that COVID is not a holiday. So we had to tell them that even though you think you're working from home, you must understand that there is a risk. So people may look for centers which are not handling COVID. If you're doing isolated procedures, then they may accept that. But people traveling as a part of the tourism package may be less. So your attempt to garner patients may be more from local areas. So your emphasis should be to probably improve your visibility locally rather than what we used to do as to try to get overseas patients, which may take more time. Or even from outside states, people may take more time. The COVID practice is a definite hindrance. Definite hindrance in the sense of wearing all these things, especially if you wear a real good COVID mask the way it should be worn. I'm sure you've worn it. Wearing it and then doing surgery is a big nuisance. In fact, one of the presenters from UK had mentioned that in their consent, they're even mentioning that the results of the surgery may not be as good as it would be in pre-COVID conditions because the surgeon is not under optimal work ethics. That is one. And if you see they even suggest GA surgeries to be around 2 hours, don't keep it longer than that. And we know that the anesthetist, the way they intubate and all that, they put a hood, they put a sheet on top, the patient is actually covered with an ENT microscope type of covering permanently on the head end under GA so that there is no aerosol spillage at any time. So there is a lot of things that have to change. And I feel that the stress, both the garments that are worn, the breathing difficulty because of wearing these tight masks are definitely something which would impede a good performance. So until it eases out, I think there are lots of things which need to be addressed or need to be accepted.
Great, sir. We've had a wonderful discussion. I mean, it's a really beautiful discussion. Now, before we close, we've got some seniors here as our participants. I would like to ask a question to them. Having seen young plastic surgeons making their presentations today on hair transplant, what do you think about the future of hair transplantation surgery? I would like to ask Dr. Chandran first and then Dr. Purushottaman.
The presentations were very good. They have gone into a lot of details, which is very good again. The future looks very bright. It should be bright. But as I told you initially, you should concentrate more on the ethics of practice. I think that is what is lacking with some of the youngsters. I'm sure Ramchandran will agree with me, because he is one of the persons right from day one who has been doing it on his own. All the 8 hours or 7 hours, he is there inside. Nowadays, I find the youngsters saying hi to the patient and putting them on the table and then walking away. That is a little disturbing to me. And unless otherwise you personally get involved, possibly the results will certainly speak in the long run. So even if it's going to be a heart transplant, you should be directly involved in that. And you should be doing everything. So with that in mind, if they concentrate on that, it should be really good and paying specialty. Of course, people at my age have already given up practicing heart transplant. So that is what I think the future holds for the youngsters.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. You have stressed on the ethics, the ethical part of it. I think the youngsters take up this issue of the whole procedure, I think we'll go great places. Dr. Purushottam, yes. Sir, what do you feel? What are your comments on this presentation?
Today's presentation, I think both of them, their attention to minute details. And he very clearly said everything is done by them except the segregation of the grafts and all those things. So I think both of them have scored very well. And I only wish them very good best wishes for them. I think teamwork is more important than, suppose if individually they have practiced at different places, it would have been a burden for them. And two of them, like-minded people forming a team, I think it's a way to go for all youngsters. Better to form a team with like-minded people and work together. Your case, he can give a help. His case, you can go and give a help. I think that should be the attitude of all youngsters instead of working on a solo basis.
That's a great point, sir. That's a great point. Team effort. I think Dr. Rajendran and Vikram have got this team effort going. And before we close, I would like to thank Dr. Ramji, sir, Dr. K. Ramachandran.
And can I just have a word, Karthi?
Yes,
Karthi,
sir. Can?
Yeah. Couple of things on the same points which Dr. Chandran and Purushottam mentioned. I had the opportunity to discuss about this with a dermatologist, and I have to bring this out, and about individually doing the surgery or spending the entire time in the theater. And they said that, you know, we see 100 patients a day. So how do you expect me to sit in the theater? So I told them, why do you have to operate? So I asked them in the face, why do you have to, when you're seeing 100 patients, send them to people who can do a job. And the reason I'm pointing out is they want to lay their hand on everything. And this is the type of answer a dermatologist seeing 100 patients a day is telling, which is obnoxious. It, you know, there is a difference between need and greed, as they say. This is a typical example of that. Second thing is, I mentioned about the technicians. And the reason I'm pointing this out is, if you're hiring, if you're borrowing, if you're stealing technicians and doing any type of ghost surgery, whoever is doing it, you will realize that ultimately you are going to face a similar or a bigger headache in the near future, where these people will kind of threaten you, they will blackmail you, and typically what they will say is that today I'm not coming. And then if you're not used to doing the surgery yourself, you have to bow down your head or do something, which means that you're under their influence. And they will not only do that, they will go one step higher. Then they will say, why should I go to a plastic surgeon? Why not I get an MBBS doctor and do this? And get more out of it, because anyway he doesn't know what is being done. And then he will say, I worked with this doctor, so I know what is being done. So this is how they go. And they spread this practice of ghost surgery. They leave you and then go to other places, and then you are stuck. So retaining the technicians is also important. Train them, retain them, don't treat them like slaves. They should know what the procedure is, and they should learn, and they should be happy with you. So the reason for doing only FUE is, many times people say, I don't have a technical support. That should not be the case. It is very easy to train. Make sure that you train one or two people and they can help you so that you are able to do the strip surgery also and do a better job. So these are the things. And the point about teamwork, absolutely right. You have to have a team. Either you have one person or two persons or whatever be it. My colleague, Dr. Ravi, has been with me through our bad days and good days. So he is about 5 years or 4 years my junior. And when he started practice, I told him to join. He said, what will I do? I said, whatever little I do, you can do that also with me. And you work wherever you are. Whenever I have a case, you come and join. At a certain point, he was able to develop the slivering, and you know, I could relegate. It's not that I was not in the theater, but certain things, you know, like the slivering can be done. And he was very good at teaching nurses. That's a very good art. Which I was not good at. So he could do a good job. He could do all these things. And more important is, supposing you are having a right and left hand combination, nothing like it. So it's very good that Rajendran and Vikram operate together, and they are trained to be right and left, or they have inherent capacity. Dr. Anil Garg, who is a hair transplant surgeon, he married a lady who was a left-hander and a right-hander. I think he is left and she is right. So yeah, he's lucky. Otherwise, you make sure that you have a good combination of right and left so that you don't come in the way. So that is something, team, and also the right type of team is important. I think these are the few words that I have to tell. Thank you. Thank you.
And, Dr. James, sir, any closing comments from you?
Excellent presentation. The youngsters, I see the future of plastic surgery in India, the youngsters are dynamic. They have leadership qualities, good technical technical excellence, and they know their rights. You can see now the young plastic surgeons are fighting to get their territories, especially the hair transplant. They are all out to get the field back into their arms. So it is because of maybe some senior surgeons lacked interest and passion for hair transplant, like the facial-maxillary surgery slowly drifted away from us. It is now the youngsters are more dynamic, and I'm very sure that they will get them back into our arena. That's all. I wish all of them very good luck.
Thank you, sir. So I would like to thank Dr. Ramji, sir, and Dr. James, sir, and all the seniors who have attended for the wonderful practical and most importantly ethical points that were stressed. That was great. It shows that plastic surgery is in good hands. And the talk by Dr. Vikram and Dr. Rajendran have shown that plastic surgery is continuing to go in the right direction. Thank you so much. And before we close this session, we'll have a sneak peek into next week's session. So the next week's session is on 11th, Tuesday at 6 p.m. We have the first speaker, Dr. Shyamnath Krishna Pandian, who's speaking on patient-specific processes in craniofacial disorders. And the moderator will be Dr. Subramanya Iyer from Kochi. And the second speaker will be Dr. Hari Krishna, speaking on mid-face reconstruction and carcinoma tongue reconstruction. And we have Dr. Subramanya Iyer moderating that session also. So I think the program is well received and encouraged by all the people, the youngsters and the seniors alike. So thank you so much for attending today. I think we shall meet next week. Thank you, sir.
Good night. Thank you, GK. Thank you, all of you. Good topics. Good coverage. and all the best for your future, Karthikeyan. I mean, Rajendran and Vikram. All the best. Have a great practice. Good luck.
Nice, sir.
Thanks a lot for the stage and with all the seniors present. It was a big privilege to talk in this and the topic that was close to our heart and in front of one of the pioneers who has a lot of passion about this. It's a big thing. Thanks for the opportunity.
Correct.